Good evening, everyone. Once again, this is the day that the Lord has made, and I don't know about you, but I'm going to choose to rejoice and be glad in it. One writer said, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me, let us exalt his name together, for truly God is worthy to be praised." Old folk used to say, "I don't know what you come to do, but I come to praise the Lord." Anybody come to give him some praise today? Amen. I'm glad that God is that encore kind of God, that he don't just bless us once, but he keep blessing us over and over again. We thank you all for the pressing of your time. We know that many of you have worked on today, thought it not robbery to go by home and clean yourselves up, that we might come and meet God at the foot of the mountain to hear what thus saith the Lord. So we want to respect everybody's time, want to stay on schedule, that the move of God might do what he needs to do, not only in this place on tonight, but in this place as well. Amen. At this time now, we're going to have our chaplain of the Concerned Ministers Fellowship to come and open us with prayer. After the opening of the prayer, then we will have the introduction of our lecturer for tonight. After the introduction of the lecturer, we will have a song by the Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church Choir. And after they have sang, then we'll be blessed with our lecture for tonight. We ask that you come in this order, please, ma'am, and please, sir.
Let me say good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
We count it as a blessing to be back in the house of prayer. Amen?
Amen.
Maybe you pray. Maybe hear it by. Gracious God, we come once again just to say thank you. Thank you, my Father, for being with us all day long. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for allowing us to come and assemble ourselves back together. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Guide us, O Heavenly Father, through this night. O Heavenly Father, and we want to thank you now for the nights that have been and passed and gone. Now, Heavenly Father, we're going to ask you, O Heavenly Father, will you please look up on our lecture tonight? And, O Heavenly Father, look up on the man that's going to bring us the word tonight. O Heavenly Father, let them, O Heavenly Father, be able to preach and teach thy word with authority and a power. And, O Heavenly Father, I pray that you just look up on humanity everywhere. O Heavenly Father, look up on the concerned part of your world, my Father. And, O Heavenly Father, look up on those who are sick right now, O Heavenly Father. And, O Heavenly Father, look up on the leaders you have in your world. O Heavenly Father, let them know, my Father, that you still God. And, O Heavenly Father, look up on this revival once again, my Father. Look up on some man or boy, girl, this sinner. Heavenly Father, don't know you in the partner of their sin. Let them know, my Heavenly Father, that the wages of sin is death. O Heavenly Father, I pray that you will lead and guide us and keep us in thy care. My Heavenly Father, bless our going and bless our coming. O Heavenly Father, when we received our word tonight, O Heavenly Father, let us be able to go out and tell mankind everywhere that you still live. And O Heavenly Father, I pray you keep all of us in thy care. And O Heavenly Father, just let us know, my Father, that without you, my Father, that we can't do anything. With you, my Father, we can do all things. Now, O Heavenly Father, we pray in your Son Jesus' name. We say amen, amen, amen.
Virtual introduction. Introduction of tonight's lecturer, Reverend Michelle Page Bush, the eldest of five children. She is the daughter of John and the late Ola Page. Her Christian foundation was formed in the Covenant AME Church, and she was educated in the Aiken County Public School System and received a Bachelor's of Arts in Political Science from the University of South Carolina, Aiken, in 1981. In 1996, she obtained her certification to teach on the secondary level and taught in the public school system for 22 years. In 2001, she earned a Master's of Education from Lesley University in Cambridge, Massachusetts. In 2004, led by the Holy Spirit, Reverend Bush entered into Erskine Theological Seminary, Due West, South Carolina, graduating with a Master's of Christian Education. In 2008, she preached her initial sermon and was licensed as a proclaimer of the gospel under Reverend Douglas A. Slaughter, pastor of the Second Baptist Church in Aiken, South Carolina. In June 2011, she was ordained through the Mount Canaan Association. Currently, Reverend Bush serves as the Associate Minister and as Minister of Christian Education at the Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church of Jackson, South Carolina, where her husband, the Reverend Paul H. Bush, is the pastor. In the work of ministry, she conducts workshop training, teachings, preaches, and serves where she is needed for the upbuilding of God's kingdom and development of disciples. Reverend Bush is a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated and co-founder of Evens Ministry and a lifetime member of the NWSB. The Bush Union, there are 4 adult children and 9 grandchildren, and they give God glory and praise for all that he continues to do. Tonight, we welcome the ministry gift of Reverend Michelle Paige Bush.
Come on, Mount Zion Choir.
Good evening, good evening, good evening. I heard you say, I love to praise his holy name. So if you love to praise his holy name, let's just give God a hand clap of praise. For he is worthy, he is worthy, he is worthy, he is worthy of all our praise, of all the glory and all the honor. He's been right here every night for these past 5 nights, and we're finishing up tonight, so we want to continue to lift him up. We want to continue to glorify him, to magnify him, and to point towards him. Amen. I greet you this evening in the name of the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I give honor this evening to the angel of this house, Reverend Robinson, and the Mount Hayden family who are hosting us, to my husband and my pastor, the pastor of the Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church, and Mount Zion's in the house, and I thank them. And to all of these ministers and those of us who are sitting in various other areas of ministry who are here tonight, I greet you and welcome and thank you. And tonight I'm here to give a lecture, and my topic tonight is on commitment. Commitment. And as you heard, I am a teacher, so I can't stand still. I'm going to walk and talk. And I also like for people to participate. And so I handed out some scripture already. Now, this particular training, or that we used as a training back in January, Mount Zion's heard. But it's still my prayer that what's said tonight does not fall on stony ground. Amen. That it will still find some fertile soil, because it's God's word. And so we're going to be using the scripture, because it is the word of God that transforms. It is the word of God that makes a difference in our lives. It's the word of God that's going to make a change. So we're going to use that scripture. So as we go through the slides and I call that particular scripture, you got to be ready. Now, I want nobody to say, oh, she's talking about me. You need to have it out. Have your glasses on. And I already told those who have it, if they can't see, then pass it to somebody else who can see. But I need you to stand up, and I need you to read it loudly and clearly. So that means you've already read it, so that you know how to pronunciate all the words before you get to them, okay? Because if you don't say them clearly, and if you don't pronounce them correctly, then it doesn't have the meaning that it should have. So treat God's word in that way. So again, here we are tonight. All right, so I'm going to use my little clicker here on here. So we want to talk about commitment. Commitment. And commitment is a very important and integral part in the Christian faith. All right. There is an organization called the Barner Group, and many of you may be familiar with it, and some of you may not be familiar with the Barner Group. But one of the things that the Barner Group has done for many, many years is collect data. And it tells us, collect data about churches, and it talks about church attendance. It talks about, you know, if churches are growing or not growing. And one of the things that it looks at all across denominations, it looks at various races, they look at large churches, small churches, and it gives us all kind of data. And one thing that has made a point about that has been happening through the years is there has been a decline in church attendance. It didn't just start with the pandemic. If you go back to the 1970s, that's when you begin to see the first decline. And I think throughout history, the more man has become self-educated, scientific-minded, technologically savvy, the more we look at the things of this world and what man can create and make, and we have less and less faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We talk a talk, but we don't always live and walk what we talk about. So commitment is a very important aspect in being a Christian, in being a Christ follower, in being a disciple of Christ. And so that's why I want to use the word of God, those scriptures, to bring home the point tonight. All right. So it says, what is commitment? What is commitment? And then if you can see underneath, it says, are you all in? At my former church, that was one of the things that we used to say, are you all in? At Mount Zion, that's what we've been talking about. Are you all in? Are you committed? Are you all in? It's not just enough to show up. It's not just enough to say it, but you got to act it out. You got to do it. You got to walk it out. And I thought about football. and we got some football fans in here, but I'm talking about the football players. And so I thought about some teams like the Dallas Cowboys. Yeah. I know I got some Dallas Cowboy fans in here. From Dallas, Texas, that's the South. And I thought about the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and we just come from Tampa. It's nice and warm in Tampa. I mean, it was hot in Tampa. But then you got teams like the Green Bay Packers, located in Wisconsin. And it gets real cold in Wisconsin. And in December, even in November and December, there could be snow on the ground. But one thing, when it's time for the Buccaneers or the Dallas Cowboys to play the Green Bay Packers, they can't say, "Coach, I don't think I'm going to Green Bay. It's snowing up there, and I'm not going." You know, the Buccaneers can't say, "Well, you know, it's real windy, and I'm not going to be able to go north." You don't get a choice about it. You own the team, and you're all in. And you might be saying, "Well, they get paid to do that." Well, I ain't talking to you then, if that's how you look at it. I'm not even talking to you if that's how you look at it. I'm talking to people who want to be committed to the walk and to the calling for which Christ has called you to fulfill. And do know that we all have a call on our lives. Some of us may have different titles, but we all have a call on our lives in this Christian walk. Our next slide four. Okay, here we go. So, commitment. What is commitment? Commitment can be defined as a decision to do what needs to be done, whatever the cost. Like showing up in Wisconsin on one of those cold, snowy days. And you know, Wisconsin, they don't have an enclosed stadium. Am I right? Yeah. Because that adds to the effect of playing Green Bay out in the cold. They're hoping that, you know, when people show up from the South, that it might be a hindrance to them to show up and have to play in the snow. In its simplest terms, a commitment is something pledged. A commitment also includes the responsibility to practice specific activities. Commitment is a way of the heart expressing itself in a way of life. And I brought, when you're talking about practice specific activities, and I have a book, and some of you may have it, and some of you may not. Some of you may have heard about it. Anybody? Richard Foster's Celebration of Discipline. Have anybody read that? Or have that book, okay? I see our brother Roger back there. He said he has it. And we talk about practicing certain activities. Somebody might say, well, you know, exactly what are those activities? And they go beyond just showing up on Sunday morning. When you practice those spiritual disciplines, it's like being on that football team and you have to show up for practice. You show up for spring training and then you show up again. You play you practice all during the year. You have specific activities that you have to engage in when you're on the team. And so you have the spiritual disciplines, and one is the inward disciplines, meditation, prayer, fasting, study. Those are the activities that we should be constantly engaged in. We have the outward disciplines, simplicity, solitude, submission, and service, another form of discipline. The corporate disciplines, which are confession, worship, guidance, and celebration. All of these are spiritual disciplines that we should practice each and every day as disciples of Christ. So commitment is a way that the heart expresses itself in a way of life. So what does the Bible say about commitment? That's what we want to talk about. That's what we want to look at tonight. What does the Bible say about commitment? You and I can say a lot. We can make all kind of excuses. We can have, you know, and most of us do know that we treat the Bible and we treat God's word as if it was a smorgasbord, a buffet at, you know, Ruby Tuesday. I'll take some of this, I'll take some of that, but I don't want of that. And we do that in our Christian walk because we'll say, "I'm not ready to give up this. I'm not going to give up that." That's why some people don't come to church. That's why some people come to church only half the time, because they don't want to hear the word of God, because the word of God is going to cut you like a two-edged sword. And it's going to cut all of us at some point in time. Some people get offended. "He talking about me. She talking about me." You ought to be cut. You ought to be. You can sit there Sunday after Sunday. Nothing don't ever touch you. And you don't ever need to be sitting in church thinking so-and-so and so I sure should have been here. Yeah, they probably should have been there, but he talking to you. All right. So we should always be doing a self-evaluation. Yep. Am I all in? Am I truly committed to what I say I'm committed to? So let's look at some biblical, let's look at biblical commitment. What does the Word of God say? So total commitment, being all in, total commitment is the foundation of our relationship with God. So I need my readers. I need some, please. Amen. Amen. So who made the greatest commitment of all? Christ. But this is Psalm 31 and 5, which it says, this is someone speaking. This is the songwriter saying, into your hands, I commit my spirit. I commit that deposit that you have made in me, Lord. I commit it to you. I give it back to you. I'm committed. I'm all in. And he says, deliver me. Romans 5:11. Amen. And I am a friend of God. Any other friends of God in here? I'm a friend. Isn't that something to be called a friend of God? When you are committed. And then our next scripture, which is 2 Corinthians 5, 17 and 21. Amen. That's a lot. That through him we might become the righteousness of God. That we are the ambassadors in the earth. That we represent him. And I heard someone that when we say and do things that are not in line with God's word, we give him a black eye. When we say and do things that are contrary to the word of God, we give Christ a black eye. Is that what you want to do? He says that we are ambassadors. And just as Christ's death on the cross, for those of us who believe and has accepted him, reconciled us back to Christ, then as ambassadors in the earth, we should be on the mission of reconciling others to God. And all that we say and do, we should be pointing to him. Pastor Matt the other night, that's what he said. Everything that we do, everything that we say, even the very thoughts that we think should glorify our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Reconciliation. Love inspires our Christian commitment. Love. And to have, oh no, did I skip one? I skipped one, didn't I? God has personally called every Christian to follow his call in a lifetime of faithful service. A lifetime of faithful service. It's not an off again, on again, when I have time, when it fits in. A lifetime of faithful service. Let me get John 10 and 27 through 28. John 10. Who got John 10? I know somebody got John 10. Okay, I'll read John 10. John 10, 27 through 28. John 10. My sheep, and I'm wondering if I wrote that right. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand when you're all in. Ephesians 5, 2. Anybody got that one? Ephesians 5, 2. All right. So walk in the way of love. And that's hard for a lot of folk. Some folk just, they just don't want to love. They love with conditions. You know, I love you if you do this. I love you as long as you do that. You know, I love you as long as you don't hurt me, disappoint me, let me down. And see, that's when we have a misunderstanding about love, because love is a verb. Love is action. Love is not just about a feeling. And that's where we get it caught up and we miss it. So that's how we can love our enemies. Recently, I've seen it on the television a couple of times, a young woman whose mother was run down by a drunk driver doing like 75 in a 35 mile zone. And she hit this car of this older woman, and her daughter had lost her mother, and she said she was so full of bitterness and so full of anger and so full of hate, and she wanted the utmost punishment for that young woman for taking her mother's life. But then one day it hit her, who her mother was and the life that her mother had lived, and that's not what her mother would have wanted. And so she got down on her knees and she prayed and asked God to help her to forgive that young woman. Now she plays a very integral part. She's almost like a godmother to the woman who murdered her mother. That's love. That's the kind of love Christ wants us to have for each other. It's not always easy, but it's what we have to choose to do. And love is a choice. It's not about a feeling. It's about a choice. That's how you stay married. Because you choose every day to love. Revelations 2:10. Who has Revelations 2:10? Revelations 2:10. All right, I'll read it. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer, I tell you. The devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you life as your victor's crown. He says, be faithful until the point of death. Some of us, we ain't gonna be faithful up until it just causes us an inconvenience. I just don't have time. I'm just too tired. I just got too many other things going on. I just can't handle that. He says, be faithful until the point of death. That's what God is looking for in us. Commitment. Love inspires our Christian commitment. And to have this kind of commitment, we also need faith. So somebody read John 14 and 15. I know somebody got John 14 and 15. I gave out a whole lot of scripture. John 14, 15. John 14, 15. Okay. John 14 and 15. All right. All right. John 14, 15. Maybe I didn't. Okay. You got 14, 15? John 14, 15? Okay. Thank you. All right. He said, if you love me, if you love me, keep my commandments. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, who has Hebrews 11 and 6? Hebrews 11 and 6 and say, without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. It says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. You can talk all you want to talk. You can lift up holy hands. You can shout hallelujah. You can do black backflips over these pews, but without faith, it is impossible to please God. He's not interested in your tears. He's not interested in your cries and pleas if you do not have faith, if you are not a real believer. Now, I can't judge you. I don't know. And a lot of people say, well, God knows my heart. And I'll say, gosh darn, does. He surely does know your heart. So being committed, the call for commitment. First of all, commitment demands a choice. Commitment demands a choice. Slide 7. Commitment demands a choice. And so I have 1 Kings 18:21. Somebody tell me about Elijah. 1 Kings 18:21. Amen. Amen. And we got to be careful. You know, one foot in the world and one foot over here. One foot in the world and one foot over here. Where are you? You can't be. There's no in between when it comes to Christ. There is no in between. There is no middle ground. You're either all in or you're not. Luke 9:23. Mm. All right. And that's where we fall off right there. Denying self. Because we can be some selfish, selfish people. Deny yourself. Give up what you want. Give up what you think is right. Give up what you think is best. Give up how you always did it to let somebody else do it. Give up because you always serve. Now it's somebody else's turn to serve. Deny yourself. And we can be some very selfish creatures. But if we are in Christ Jesus, he says the only way you can say that you are my disciple is that you are willing to deny yourself. Is that sometime? Is that every now and then? How often is it? All the time, every day. Sometimes we need to start our mornings off with just finding a place to lay prostrate out on the floor and say, Lord, let just a little bit more of me die today so that more of you might live. That's how when you pray that prayer in earnestness and sincerity, he will do it. More and more of you will die so that more of him might live in you. Commitment definitely limits choices because it's exclusive. You got to be all in. And I say, I'm not better than anyone, but I'm different. I'm in the world, but I'm not of the world. I ain't better than nobody, but I'm different. I'm a peculiar person. I'm a part of a royal priesthood, and I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yeah, I'm different. I don't cuss. I don't fuss. I don't chew. I don't smoke. But that don't make me no better than nobody else. And I just don't do those things because I'm saved. I just never did those things. But I'm just saying, I ain't got nothing against nobody who do necessarily. I'm not better. I'm just different. So commitment builds up faith and develops character. It is a spiritual discipline which requires time, work, and determination. So if the only time you show up for church is on Sunday morning, you're missing it. Because we come on Sunday morning to worship and to fellowship. We come at other times, be it Wednesday night, Tuesday night, or Saturday morning, to train and be equipped. We call it Bible study. We call it Sunday morning. We call it Sunday school. Your pastors probably regularly host some type of trainings for your particular ministry, but we come to be equipped for the work. And every time we get trained, we're shaving off some more of that worldliness so that we can have more Christ-likeness. We have to make a commitment, and it takes time. It does take work, and it takes determination. It's not about what you say. It's about what you do. Deny yourself. Self-life manifests itself in self-indulgence, self-love, self-will, self-seeking, self-pride. Somebody read Matthew 16, 25 and 26.
Matthew 16, 25 and 26. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life will still find it. 26. What good will it is to be for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul?
Right there. God's word. We can't alter that. We can't change it. We can't water it down. It's God's word. You got to either accept it for what it is or you're not in. There's no choice. It's exclusive. To one person, self may be intellectual pride. To another, it may be pleasure. For another, business or family. You know, we can all have our own little whatever that we got to do this. We got to go here. We got to take care of this. And all of this is more important than following Christ. And I know God understands I have to go to work. And I know God understands that, you know, I got to take my child to the football game. And I know God understands. I don't know. He says he comes first. He comes first in all things. That's just those who have put their hands to the plow. You can't be looking back. He says, when it come right to it, he said, between me and your mother, me and your child, me and your husband, he said, I come first. That doesn't mean that you neglect, but you just got to remember to be with him first. Now, I'm not necessarily talking just about church attendance right here either, because we don't want to make a mistake between being in church and being in Christ. That can be two totally different things. You should be in church, yes. You should go to church, yes. But I'm talking about a relationship and a commitment to Christ. To deny, did we do Matthew 19? Matthew 19. Amen. That says it right there, that you have left mother, father, children. You can't let those people hinder you for what Christ is calling you to do. You can't let them hinder you when he has a mission for you to carry out in this world. So no one can come before him. I love my husband and I know that he loves me, but we both know that Christ comes first. Christ comes first. So to deny self means to surrender yourself completely and unconditionally to Christ. Philippians 3, 7 and 10.
That I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his suffering, becoming like him in his death.
Amen. Amen. That says it all right there. That says it all. I want that. I want that. But I believe that I will have that more than anything. All right, our next slide. How strong is your commitment? How strong is your commitment to God? Self-evaluation. Are we pursuing an intimate relationship with God above all else? And we know what it means to be intimate, to be close, to know someone personally, to be able to talk with them and they talk with you, and you can share your innermost fears, your desires. You know, you can share that with God. And if you listen, if you're still and you listen, he talks to you. He walks with you and he talks with you. So pursue an intimate relationship with God. Sometimes you got to learn to be still and you got to learn to be quiet. You got to have a secret place of your own that you can go and sit and talk with God and listen for him. Serving Christ with all our time, our abilities, our treasure, and our energy. Now, which one of those do we sometimes have the most issues with? Treasure. Mm-hmm. Preacher get to talking about money. We start crossing our legs and filling our pocketbooks. And he ain't talking to me. But Jesus talked all about money. He talks about money. And so we are to give of our time, our abilities, our treasure, and our energy. All of that is a part of worship. Delighting in God's goodness and his ability to meet all our needs. We just thank him and we praise him and we glorify him. And we always know that he may not come when we want him, but he's always what? On time. Letting God take and use our life in whatever way will please him the most. And sometimes we'll get to praying and we'll get to asking God for this and asking God for that, pouring out. Do we ever just stop and say, Lord, what it is that you would have me to do? Lord, where it is that you would have me to go? Get up in the morning and say, Lord, in our prayer, Lord, give me somebody to speak to the day that I might just leave a trace of Jesus. Maybe it's a smile. Maybe it's a kind word. Maybe it's a testimony. But that should be our daily prayer when we get up in the morning when I go out. Instead of just hustling and bustling, I got to hurry up and get here, and I got to hurry up and get there. I got to hurry up and do this and do that. So, Lord, what is it that you want me to do today? What is it you would have me to do? Let God use us every day, every day. Our next slide. The marks of a committed Christian. Do you bear the marks of a committed Christian? To live for the glory of God, the very purpose for which we exist is to give glory to God, so that this is the first mark of a committed Christian. We glorify God when we in any way praise or acknowledge or experience or display his attributes. And sometimes it's just not the words that we say, but sometimes it's not saying anything at all. And people to know there's something special about us. When we walk in a room, the atmosphere ought to shift when we show up. We ought to light up the room. When we say something, we should always be encouraging. We should always be uplifting. Sometimes people don't like that. They say, oh, goodness gracious, here she comes. She's always so positive. Every time I start to complain, she says something else. I know I've had some people just tell me, shut up. Because I didn't have anything negative to say. I didn't even have anything negative for the feedback for what they were saying negative. They came with some gossip. I just said, that sure is bad. They start running her down. I said, Lord have mercy. Well, I sure hope and pray that. And that's how you shut people up. You said, well, let's pray for them. Just say right now, let's just pray for them. Instead of engaging in it, instead of listening to it, say, let's pray for them. And that'll shut people up and they'll stop bringing their garbage to you. But long as they know you the garbage can they can put something into, they're going to keep calling you. They're going to keep coming by to see you. So God is looking for people who glorify him in all that they do, in every way that they live. Slide 11. To live a life of love. Love is how we identify ourselves as Christians. Christians have a new God-given capacity to love the love that is a fruit of the Spirit. We are commanded to love as Jesus loved. We are commanded to love as Jesus loved. Christ gave his life. He forgave. He accepted. He welcomed. And that's how we're supposed to be. We can't be so hard-hearted and stiff-necked that we don't like these people and we don't want to accept these people and we don't have anything to offer these people because they don't look like my people. They don't act like my people. They don't talk like my people. God does not see our outward appearance. He is looking at who we are on the inside. He is looking at who he created us to be. He is looking at who we are becoming and not just who we are. And we can be, when we become mature, that's how we begin to look at other people. We can make a judgment about somebody. Their pants are sagging. Their dress is too tight. They're showing too much. They're revealing too much. They cuss. And I don't like it. Oh, I can't stand cussing. I never have. But you know what? I still have to love and accept people just because they're different. Or their behavior is not something I appreciate, I still have to think, these are still God's children. These are God's children. These are his creation, no matter what, no matter who. They are still his creation. We pigeonhole people. We've drawn little squares, and we stuck this group in here, and we stuck that group in there, and we stuck this group over here, and we relegated this group to this level and this group to that level. That ain't got nothing to do with God. And when we are fully committed, we want to erase those things out of our minds and begin to try to see people as God sees them. Love. When Christ comes back, he said, how is he going to know me? How will he recognize me? How will he know I'm one of his own? He will know me by my love. That's how he'll know me. Slide 12. And so the marks of a committed Christian to live a life of service, God has given gifts to every believer to do the job God's wants done. We are to be faithful in serving fellow believers and in being a faithful witness for Christ. Be a witness. Be a witness. Be a witness. Be a witness. I hear the term evangelical and it's attached to this certain group of people. I don't even know who they are, but they always getting these things attached to them, like the word conservative and all of that. But you know what? We all supposed to be evangelicals. We are all, if we are in Christ, we are supposed to be evangelicals. Those are people who are supposed to be telling people about the good news of Jesus Christ. That's what it's supposed to be about. Now, all that other stuff they're getting hanged on and tagged to, I don't know nothing about that. But I know we're supposed to be evangelicals, people who are telling people about the good news of Jesus Christ. Let me have John 21, 15 right quick in 1 Corinthians. Can I get John 21? Anybody got that one? John 21. On slide 12. John 21, not John, yeah, John 21, 15 and 17. I might have wrote it down wrong. Okay, go ahead.
When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon, Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Verse 16, again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. Verse 17, the third time, he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep.
My sheep. Exactly. Amen. Thank you, my brother. Feed my sheep. And that's what we as Christ followers are supposed to be doing. Evangelicals. Sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. Not pointing out my faults. Not pointing out my shortcomings. Not pointing out what you don't like about me because I don't do it like you do it. But we're supposed to be telling people about the good news of Jesus Christ. An evangelical. 1 Corinthians 12, 1 through 11. Amen. And you, go ahead. I'm sorry. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So the various fruits of the Spirit, and we can't do anything except we have the Holy Ghost. Not anything that has any power, not anything that has any worth, not anything that has any lasting power, not anything that has any transformative power, except through the Holy Spirit, the indwelling Holy Spirit, the marks of a committed Christian. We're getting close to my time, so we're just going to move to wrap it up. A life of loyalty to Jesus Christ. Believers must be willing to give up that which hinders being faithful to Christ. You must give up anything that hinders you. You might have to give up somebody. You might have to give up some activities. You might have to give up some places you used to go, some things you used to do. You might need to stop watching some of them Tyler Perry shows you watching or reading some of them books you watching, reading, because it's hindering you from being faithful to Christ. Because whatever you eat, whether it's through your mouth, your ears, or your eyes, that's what you become. That's what you become. So you have to be careful. I don't care because it's on TV. I don't care because you might think you like what he does, or how he does it. But a lot of it be garbage. And garbage in, garbage out. All right, moving on because we're losing time. Partial commitment is no commitment. You can't be half in and half out. Partial commitment is no commitment. God requires us nothing less than total commitment. There's no way to live the Christian life without total commitment. You got to be all in. Just because our circumstances change does not mean our commitment should. Now, I got to share this right here. This is slide 14. Let me find that. This is Daniel. This is Daniel, slide 14, Daniel. We look at Daniel's situation. We know where Daniel was. Daniel was in a foreign land. It said if anyone, Daniel, let me get Daniel. Daniel 6, 4. It says that the administration and the satraps tried to find grounds for for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said, we will never find any basis for charges against this man, Daniel, unless something to do with the law of his God. So that's when they, you know, cooked up some things and said, well, if you're caught praying, because, you know, Daniel prayed several times a day. So they made up something that they could trip him up in that would be against what he was called to do by God. And a lot of us, we won't. We say, well, you know, on my job, I can't talk about Jesus on my job. The devil is a liar. If they can cuss on the job, you can talk about Jesus on the job. I was a teacher, and I told them, they said, oh, Miss Bush, you know you're not supposed to talk about the Lord. And I wasn't trying to invite them to salvation or anything like that, but I called on the name of the Lord. When I talked, I had him in my conversation. So if they could walk around cussing and fussing and fighting, I know I could talk about my Jesus. But if it caused me to lose my job, so be it. Now, when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and praised, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. And then he ended up in the lion's den, but God didn't forsake him. And that's the kind of faith and trust we have to have in our Lord and Savior. As we walk this Christian walk, we can't look at the world around us and let it dictate to us who we are and how we should act. We have to be the one that stands up and stands out. We have to be that light. We have to be that difference. We ought to be the change agents in the world and not the world impacting and changing us. We don't have to follow every trend that comes along. We need to stand up and say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to wear that, because I'm going to be the change agent. What a big difference this world would be if we stood up and did what we were supposed to do as Christians. Commitment. You're either committed or you're not. Commitment to personal growth. We are called to commit ourselves as disciples. Commitment to ministry. We must commit ourselves to the ministry of the local church and use the spiritual gifts that God has given us. So should we be in church? Yes, we should. The world is a lie when they say you don't have to go to church to say you believe in God. Now, you can say that. You can say that. But that's not true, because the word tells us that we should not neglect the assembling of ourselves. And so anyone who wants to say, they're just making up excuses. Those are just excuses, because they don't want to do what's right anyway. And they're not truly in Christ. And I'll say it. You're not. You're not. You cannot be in Christ and live outside the church. And the church is a community of believers, not necessarily a building, but in community. And most of these people who say that, they're not in a community of believers. They home on Sunday morning, sitting on the couch, or still in the bed. Maybe they got it turned on to a church service, but they're not really paying attention. They're not really following, because being a Christian, being a Christ follower, means you are engaged, meaning you are active, meaning that you are working together with other Christians. And we come together to encourage one another, to uplift one another, to love on one another. And when I'm not there, and one of my brothers and sisters, we missed you last Sunday. That feels good. And so that concludes our time on commitment and what is commitment through the word of God, not through Michelle, but through the word of God. Amen. Amen.
Let's give God another hand of praise for our lecture on tonight. Like we said, you can look at it however you want, but you either all in or you're all out. You can't straddle the fence. And so we really need to think about our commitment to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I know for the last few years now, one of our themes at Mount Zion has been that we're making sure that we are working on our relationship with Jesus and not just our religion. So it's either religion or relationship. And many of us have got caught up in religion, but we ain't got no relationship. Amen. And that is what we need. So thank you again, Reverend Bush, for sharing with us on tonight. We hope that maybe you was able to grab some pictures, read the scriptures, and then most of all, let's leave tonight, you know, asking ourselves, am I fully committed? With that, just before Reverend Guyton comes up, once again, we want to say thank you to all of you who not just joined us here physically in the building, but also to those who are joining us out in the Facebook world. We also want you to know that we, the Concerned Ministers Fellowship, is letting people know each night, regardless of where you come from, we are the Concerned Ministers Fellowship of the CSRA. Anybody know that the CSRA, that is the Central Savannah River area? We go from Aiken to Augusta to Edgefield, even tip over into the Savannah area. You do not have to be a minister, slash, you do not have to be a preacher to be a part of the Concerned Ministers Fellowship. It has been emphasized all throughout this week. You can call yourself what you want, but if you're a Christian and if you're a child of God, you're a minister. You're going to be ministering in one way or the other. That gift, that talent that God has given you, you should be ministering with it. You do not have to have the title of a preacher. Amen. But with the Concerned Ministers Fellowship, if you're concerned about the condition of the world, if you're concerned about the rights and equality for all people, as our NAACP leader told us on last night, for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, there is a place for you in our organization. There are a few of us here on tonight. I'm just going to ask that everybody that's a part of the Concerned Ministers Fellowship, would you just stand wherever you are, those who are a part. And let's give them a hand. All throughout the week, they have been coming, and certainly we thank them. We also want to let you know that on Good Friday, the Concerned Ministers Fellowship will be over in Augusta, Georgia, at the Hudson Memorial. I keep wanting to get closer calling them Baptist Church. Amen. But with Reverend Brendan and Jenkins Bozeman, that is where our seven last sayings from the cross will be on this year. So at the latter part of March, we'll be looking forward to meeting you all there with us with the seven last sayings from the cross. And then I'm going to ask for a little bit of help from Keith and Roger. But again, this year, here in Aiken, over in Hopeland's Garden, we'll be coming together again for Together for Hope. Something of this nature, on a bigger scale. In each scale, Keith and I was talking, and we continue to talk throughout, but how do we expect the world to come together when the church can't come together? You know, how can we expect for there not to be racism and discrimination and everything in the world when it's showing up in the church? And so if there's no hope in the church, for the church, and through the church, then where is the world supposed to get their hope? And so we want to invite you, one of those dates, Keith, Roger, May 22nd and May 23rd. May 22nd, May 23rd. We will be at Hopeland's Garden in Aiken. You will be seeing flyers on our website. If you can make either night or both nights, you will be glad that you did. We want to invite you to come out with us as ecumenical groups from across the CSRA will be coming together to lift up Jesus before the world. Amen. Amen. At this time now, we're going to ask our treasurer, the Reverend Wesley Guyton, to come and share with you how you might be able to plant a seed into this ministry.
Thank you. Church said, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise glory Lord. To God. We are truly grateful, and we truly are so blessed all this week. The Spirit has been in the house all week long. It's just been a blessing each and every night, from the lectures to the sermons. And I tell you, we've just been rejoicing and enjoying ourselves all this week. Everyone have done an excellent job. And we can't help but to say we appreciate it so very much. And we're grateful tonight. We thank God for Pastor Michelle for sharing with us commitment. Because everywhere I go, and I hear it from others too, that seem like the church is not committed. And I don't know, but it seemed like that the pandemic shouldn't have caused us to be uncommitted. Seemed like coming out of it, we ought to have gotten more committed. But seemed like it went the other way. But I know God's got a plan. I ain't got to worry about that. God's got a plan. And I'm grateful for the plan that he have. And we're grateful here tonight. Amen. We are Concerned Minister Fellowship, and we're grateful for this nonprofit organization here and CSRA, as Pastor Bush has already stated. And we truly thank you all for your support all this week. And tonight, Friday night, it's been good. And we're grateful. And if you're giving by Cash App, it's up $CMF funds, FUNDS. And many have been given by Cash App. Some have not been able to get here, but they have been doing it through Cash App. And we appreciate that so very, very much. And if you're writing a check, you can do so by just writing CMF on the check, and that will be suffice. And you don't have to write the whole thing out. We accept cash and just however you want to give. We're just grateful for that, because we do various things in the community, amen. And also we offer scholarships as well to our first-time college students, two-year technical schools as well. And so we're grateful that we're able to help somebody start on a new journey when they get out of high school, because that's so important that we invest in our young people. And we've heard it all this week that we got to make an investment. And it's been said also, where is your treasure? Life gonna cost something. We don't get through it by having a pen, nothing. It's a cost to it. And we know Jesus paid the price already. Well, we got a cost to pay too. And so we are grateful tonight, and we thank you all in advance for what you're going to do tonight. And we appreciate it so very, very much. And I just have to say that we thank the host church, Hayden, who's been so gracious all this week, and that Pastor Robinson, amen. God bless him. And truly, we just been had a great time all this week, and couldn't have a better host. I tell you, we couldn't have a better host. So we just want to let you know that we appreciate you so very much. So at this time, we're going to ask our members to help us out. We're going to receive our offering for tonight, and then we're going to move further into the program. Amen. Thank you. Let me stand for our prayer, please.
Father God, we want to thank you for what we have received, oh God. God, we want supposed to do, oh God. And God, we just want you to just bless us more, God, so we can give more back to you, oh God. So we can return 100-fold, oh God. Bless the hands that gave and bless the hands that didn't give, God, that wanted to give. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor Guy, I'm going to ask you and Reverend Brown for just a second. If you just sit that right there for just a minute, I'm doing something a little different tonight, and it is for a reason. I'm going to ask all of the members of the Concerned Ministers Fellowship, would you just come up and stand with me for a moment? And just before we have a song by Mount Sinai, and we have the introduction of our preacher, again, we thank God for this 2024 revival. Concerned Ministers Fellowship have been doing this for a number of years. And this year, the revival has been just as powerful as ever. But in the midst, there's still someone missing. The Reverend Pearl Stallworth was a lifelong member of the Concerned Ministers Fellowship. She was our secretary for a number of years, but she wasn't just our secretary. She was an encourager. She was a supporter. She was committed. She was all in. And she was there, as Reverend Bush said, until and unto death. And we miss her dearly. We miss her dearly. And this year's revival, although power, glory, and honor, and everything goes to God, it also comes in memory of our good friend and our sister, the Reverend Pearl Stallworth. So if you would give us just a moment, we are going to take a moment that we recognize our friend and our sister. Amen. We just want you all to just remain for just a second. We want to give Reverend Robinson an opportunity to do something for us.
The life of Reverend Dr. Pearl Stallworth.
Okay, yesterday we had choir rehearsal, but now we can sing it for real. Come on, help us sing this song. Here we go. The Lord is my shepherd, everybody.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Defender behind me,
defender behind me.
Y'all been practicing. I won't fear.
I won't fear.
Filled with anointing.
I'm filled with anointing.
Thank you, Jesus.
My cup's overflowing.
No weapon.
Let's give God a hand of praise for his angel, the Reverend Pearl Stallworth. Thank you, Concerned Ministers Fellowship. Thank you. At this time, we're going to ask that Mount Sinai would come up and give us a selection. After this selection, then we will have the introduction of our preacher for tonight. And again, I'm going to tell you what I told you last night. If you got some extra hair, make sure it's tied down. If your shoes too tight, you can kick them off now. Because we are going to be in for a treat from our preacher for tonight. There's some extra mics behind you. Come on, bless us, Mount Sinai.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. If you love the Lord, somebody say, I love Jesus. Come on, some of y'all, we've been sitting down all night. Can you just stand up and just lift that hand and say, I love Jesus? Or somebody say, I love Jesus. Look at somebody sitting next to you or sitting behind you, say, I love the Lord. When I was growing up in church, they say, reason why I love him, tell somebody why you love him. Why? Because he first loved me. Because he purchased my salvation. Because he woke me up this morning. He kept me all day long. Y'all ain't saying that to me. Look at somebody, tell him why you love him. Clap those hands and give him glory. The song is a real simple song. Says, the splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, the darkness try to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. Y'all help me say, how great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, we'll see how great is our God? Let's say it again. How great? Our God. Say it with me. How great, oh, we'll see how great is our God. Oh, age to age, he stands. Time is in his hand, beginning and the end. Beginning and the end, the God is three and one, Father, Father, Spirit, and Son. He's the Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great! Somebody clap your hands. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Can we say it again? How great, oh, my, 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 my. Oh, how great. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. I love this part. It says, he's our name above all names. Yeah. Worthy of our praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God. Can we say it together? He's the name. Worthy, 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 worthy. And my heart will say, how great is our God. Let's say it again. Name above all names. Worthy, 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 worthy. And my heart will say, how great. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. It's our God. Let's say it again. Name above all names. Oh, my, 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 my. Worthy. And my heart. How great is our God. How great, how great, how great. How great is our God. Everybody say, how great. Oh, we'll see how great. How great is our God. Let's say it one more time. Everybody clap your hands. How great. Everybody just clap your hands. Hey, hey, hey. It's our God. Oh, we'll see how great. How great. Turn it around. How great. How great. How great. Say it again. How great. How great. Yeah, how great. Oh, my, my. One more time. How great. How great is our God. If you know you serve a great God, throw that hand up right where you are. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Come on, everybody. How great thou art. How great thou art. Come on, that's a good place to give him glory right there. Come on, that's a good place to give him glory. Come on, that's a good place to say thank you, Jesus. Yeah. We're getting ready for the word on tonight. I don't know about you, but earlier this week on Tuesday night, we was told to have choir rehearsal. Let me tell you something. And I'm always asked, why do you praise God the way that you do? On Tuesday, I was getting ready for choir rehearsal. Let me start from Monday, Sunday night. I was lying in my bed. And I was dozing off to sleep. And I could hear something saying, I literally heard a voice say, I'm going to kill you. And I felt that life was leaving my body. I couldn't move. I couldn't even breathe. I'm sweating bullets. And I don't know what's going on, man. I couldn't hardly, like I was suffocating. And I was falling through the bed like life was leaving my body. And I got up when it lasted about 2 minutes. And I got up and I began to say, thank you, Jesus. And I walked through the house. Monday, getting ready to come to choir rehearsal, tiredness hitting my body so hard, I couldn't hardly hold my eyes open. And I just, and my wife was asking me, say, what is wrong with you? I said, I don't know. I'm just so tired. I don't know what's going on. I said, I don't know what happened last night. I don't know. Sunday night, I don't know what's happening with me today. I said, but one thing I know, that God, that's God that I serve, he's able. See, y'all ain't got to say nothing to me. See, I'm a preacher's kid, so my mama and my daddy was preachers. And one thing they taught me, that when things got tough in my life, how did I get a hold to God? She said, sometimes you can't, when you can't call the doctors, you can call on Jesus. When you can't get in touch with the pastor, she said, his line is never busy. When you can't call on your friend, you can always call on Jesus. All I can do is open my mouth and say, Jesus, you came through before and I know you'll do it again. Somebody open your mouth. Rear your head back and say, hey. Somebody open your mouth and give him glory. We're getting ready for the word tonight. High five your neighbor and say, oh, neighbor, I don't know about you, but somebody told me that this was a revival. Look at your neighbor and say, it's revival time. Now open your mouth, rear your head back, and say, yeah. When I was a boy, my daddy would put up tents all over the country. We've been out everywhere from Florida to Alabama, because I'm from Florida. So Alabama, Georgia, New Mexico, Texas, the Jamaica, the Bahamas, everywhere, all across the world, putting up those tents. And it was something about Friday nights. My daddy would get up, he said, it's Friday night. Y'all know what that means. He said, it's Holy Ghost night. We getting ready for Pastor Larry Carter, but I need y'all to do me one favor. Grab that neighbor by the hand. Shake that neighbor's hand. Shake them and rock them. Rock them and shake them. And say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but I came to be revived. I refuse to go home the same way that I came. Open your mouth, rail your head back, and say, yeah. It's something we do that's like, oh. Clap your hands and receive Pastor Larry Carter, everybody.
Virtual introduction of our guest revivalist.
God looked down through time and saw a child whom his favor would be granted and through whom his plan could be fulfilled. This man of valor, diligence, and a vision is Pastor Larry Carter. He has a tremendous passion for God's word, coupled with a love for God's people. He has a contagious and charismatic spirit that flows through every facet of his personality and ministry. Pastor Larry Carter was born February 22nd. He accepted Christ at a very early age and has been pastor of St. Sinai Baptist Church for 20 years. Pastor Carter graduated from Hepzibah High School and received an associate's degree from Anderson Theological Seminary. He is currently pursuing his Bachelor's of Theology. Pastor Carter has received numerous awards. He started a ministry called Higher Standard Men's Ministry, where he teaches men how to be biblical men and to live a higher standard than word. He's always finding time to assist in whatever way he can. He truly has a heart of a servant. He is a very passionate preacher and a teacher of God's word. He He is married to the lovely lady Beverly Carter, and together they have two children. He is not ashamed.
Amen. 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 If you love the Lord tonight and you're glad to be among the land of the living, you ought to give God some praise. Amen. The Bible said, let everything that has breath do what? Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise shall continually be in my mouth, regardless of what goes on and what not go on, what goes up, what comes down, in, out, whatever the case may be, the valleys, the mountain experiences, we ought to give God praise anyhow. Amen. Amen. And so we greet each and every one of you tonight in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to the pastor of this church, Hayden Baptist, Pastor Robinson, to Pastor Bush, Reverend Bush, to the Concerned Ministers Fellowship. Amen. And to all of you in your respective places, and to these, all these preachers, pastors, evangelists, and to your spouses, we thank God for each and every one of you. We count it a blessing to be a part of such a great, amen, great revival. I've been looking in at a couple of, when I had time this week, and truly God has been in the place all week long. Amen. And we thank God for what God is doing through this organization and through Pastor Bush and all of you who are working so diligently to make a difference in this world, in this community. And we thank God for you. Amen. I want to thank God right now for our church at Mount Sinai. Thank you for coming over to our musician, drummer. Thank you so very much. Amen. To our usher ministry, we thank God for you for coming over and being with us as well. Amen. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. Amen. I certainly want to thank God for my dear friend, amen, who surprised me, had no idea she was coming. Amen. Sister Charlene Johnson, we thank God for you, sister, for coming by. Amen. We bless God for you. Not going to hold you long, amen, because we know how we are. Amen. We can go other places and stay. We can waste time other places, 2, 3, 4 hours. Am I right about it? Yeah, we can do it, but it's something about being in church on a Friday night. Amen. Somebody probably already thinking we done been here already a little bit too long. I hope. Come on, can we keep it real? We have this saying over at Mount Sinai. We just keep it real. Amen. Somebody by me saying, Lord, I sure hope he ain't going to be long. Lord, I praise you. Amen. But we gonna do what the Lord said do. Is that all right? Amen. Amen. If you have your working tools, I want you to go with me briefly, but yet led by the Holy Spirit, Acts chapter number 2. We're going to look at verses 1 through 7, Acts chapter 2. Reading to you, if it's okay, from the King James Version of the Bible, Acts chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was what?
Fully come.
Now, watch this. They were all with one accord in one place. I want to stop right there. I want to and just say this. I want to, that one place, they were all on one accord in one place. He didn't say they were in church. He said they were in one place. Underline one place in your mind, and we're going to keep reading. Verse 2, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty what? And it filled all the house where they were sitting.
And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire. Now, it wasn't fire, but like as a fire. And it sat upon each of them. Key, verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. As the Spirit gave them utterance. The Spirit gave them utterance. Somebody say, the Spirit gave them utterance. Verse number 5. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia, all those places. Verse number 6. Now, when this was noise abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. Verse 7, and they were all amazed. Somebody say amazed. And marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? I want to challenge you to keep reading, you know, in your spare time. But for tonight, we're going to stop right there. And I want to talk about experiencing a church revival. You may be seated. Experiencing a church revival. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, we're going to talk about experiencing a church revival. Now give God a hand clap of praise. Father, we thank you right now for your grace, your mercy. And Lord, we ask that you would be one in our midst. Now move, God, as only you can do. Somebody needs to know that there still is a reality in serving a true and living God. Bread of heaven, feed us now until we want no more. Lord, if there be anything that hinders this word from taking root in our spirits and in our souls, Lord, we ask in the mighty name of Jesus the Christ to remove it right now. And like David would say, create, O God, within us a clean heart and renew within us the right spirit. It's in the name of Jesus the Christ we pray, and let every heart say amen. Experiencing a church revival. Reverend Bush didn't know it, but she was all over my word tonight, all over the sermon. It was just confirmation after confirmation. Amen. That's why I'm not going to be very long, because she done already preached. Amen. I'm just going to piggyback off of some of the points that she made, and we're going to bless the Lord and go on home. Is that all right? Experiencing a church revival. I want to say a word about church revival from Acts chapter 2. You know, when God revives his collective people, the church. Now, can I be quite honest? Unfortunately, many people do not understand the word church. Too many people, perhaps most people, believe that church is a building located where I go to worship God. Come on, somebody. And to be spiritually motivated. And where I can return again next week to repeat it all over again. From Benny, this is the sum total of church. But the word church, my brothers and sisters, is taken from the Greek word pronounced ekklesia, which means a called out group or an assembly. I want you to catch that part about called out, because the church ought to be different than the world. While you and I must live in the world, but God tell us not to be of the world. Let me just talk about that for a moment, because I often wonder, you know, if God were to put the world means that system that is in place, that is ran by the devil, that opposes the things of God, a system. There's a system that opposes the things of God. And I often wonder if God put the world, that system, in a box, and the church, the body of Christ, in the box, and stir them together, would we be able to determine and see the difference between the church and the world that God has called us out of. Yeah, we got it. I think we got it confused. Amen. While we are not perfect folk, but we serve a perfect God. And the Bible says to be holy, for I am holy. The word holy means to be set apart so that God can use us. See, I'm going to tell you something. God can't use everybody. Because some of us are not spiritually there. We're not clean enough that God can use us. Now God can clean us up. Don't get it twisted. Thank God he done cleaned all of us. He done moved something from all of us. Am I right about it? Because some of us and all of us are ex something. You ought to say something up in here. Yeah, all of us are ex something, and we praise God tonight that he cleaned us up, but yet there is room for improvement. We ought not be walking right here like we got it together now. We don't walk around like we, oh God, I'm ready, because I believe that when we are reach a certain point, God will say, you need to come on home. God, I praise you right there. Come on home. But I thank God every day, Pastor Bush, when he wakes me up, the grace of God, because it gives me another chance to do better today than I don't know about you, than I did on yesterday. Am I right about it? And so it comes from the Greek word ekklesia, which means called out group of people. Somebody ought to praise God right there. Amen. A called out group of people. So when you think of church, we want you to think of it more than just a building where people gather for mutual stimulation, mutual spiritual edification, and mutual spiritual inspiration. You are, and I am, a part of God's legislative body. I wish I had time to explain that. Let me say this. God has put you and I on earth to do business for him until he come back. We are here to legislate. In other words, carry out the principles of God in the earth. That's why he says in Matthew, he says, you are the salt of the earth. And you are the light. Now, he wasn't talking about brick and mortar. He was talking about saved folk who have been saved and baptized. He said, now you are the salt of the earth and you are the light of the world. Salt ought to change the taste. Come on, somebody. You sprinkle salt on your food, it changes the taste. Am I right about it? And so then we ought to be salty people. We ought to change the taste of that of the world. And not only change the taste, salt also will make you thirsty. That's why some of y'all who used to go bar hopping and they put those peanuts right there on the bar. Now, I ain't been there, but I heard about it. Yeah, they put them peanuts right there. You know why they put those peanuts there? You keep eating on those peanuts. Peanuts got salt on them. And the more you eat peanuts, yeah, come on, somebody, you're going to become what? Thirsty. And the more you get, look here, I wish I had somebody to praise him right there. Uh-huh. And as you become thirsty, see, you drink a little more. Can we tell the truth here tonight? Yeah. And God says that you ought to make folk thirsty for me. That is for the Lord Jesus. Yeah. Blessed are they who thirst and hunger after righteousness, for they shall be filled. We have to do business on earth, in earth, while we are here until the Savior comes back. So we are his legislative body in earth. We legislate. God expects for us to tell folk all about him and show them how to live. That's what the church ought to be doing. See, many folk don't want to come to church because those of us who are in the church act like folks full of hell. And, oh, God, I wish somebody, it's going to get a little tight, but see, we got a hellish spirit, you know what I'm saying? And folk could tell you, the reason I don't go to church is because of the folk in there. That's not God's will for the church. It's not God's will for the body of Christ. We ought to love everybody, regardless of their condition, regardless of what they got going on, because God loves us all unconditionally. I know you ain't gonna say much right there. You done got quiet already. It is the role of the church. Jesus said, "I will build my ecclesia," and he said, "And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." I wish I can pause right there for a moment and just let you know. See, as long as you are a part of that body, the church, you do not have to fear what Satan try to do, because God promised the church that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. And while we are crying and complaining and losing our mind, God said, didn't I tell you that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church? What is the problem? What is the problem, Carter? What is the problem? Obviously, the church needs a revival. Yeah. And the reason why we need a revival, that is the church, is because with all of these churches, on all of these corners, with all of these ministries, with all of these preachers, with all of these pastors, with all of these choir members, with all of the musicians, with all of the ushers, how can we have all of this and have the mess that we have in our world today? Something is wrong. I wish I had just two people on this side to say amen. Something is wrong. Something is seriously wrong. Because how can we have all of this? Revivals on Friday, revivals on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and church on Sunday, and still have a mess. Something is wrong. Am I right, Robbie? Something is wrong. What could it be? We need to identify the problem so that we can bring a solution to the mess that we're faced with every day. I don't believe that we ought to show up on a Sunday and have church, or what we call church, and go home and folk are still losing their mind. Folk are still walking around with the pants down. Marriages are still going south. Churches are breaking up in divisions and all of this mess. We can't get along with one another. So much hatred in the world. Can I stop right there? Don't clap too quick, because there's a lot of hatred in the world and there's some hatred within the body of Christ. There's some envy in the world, but there's some envy in the church. There is arguments and division in the world, but you find the same thing in the church. Then where can I go that I don't find the hell that I'm faced with all week? Lord, I praise you. I need that one place, because when I go to work, I got demons all around me. God, I praise you. When I leave work, there's problems. There's situations. I can't go nowhere and find peace. But the one community of folk that I ought to be able to go and be a part of and find rest and find peace and find joy is the church. The body of Christ. The church. My brothers and sisters. Is not being, perhaps, or even not doing what its creator has called her to do. And therefore, it has become anemic, and she has lost her power and effectiveness. Yeah. So the church needs to be revived. And there's no greater illustration of a red hot revival other than Acts chapter number 2. That's where you find when the church was born. Yeah, the church was born, and it was born in the context of a red hot revival. Acts chapter 2 talks about it. And I'm reminded of Luke when he told Theophilus in Acts chapter 1 about Jesus. He says, "Oh, Theophilus, let me tell you about the former treaties that God began to do and all of the things he said until he was taken up." And then Luke tells Theophilus, he says, I want to skip down a moment. He told his disciples, he said, "I want you to wait right here. I don't want you to go do anything. I don't want you to do ministry. I don't want you to try to sing. I don't want you to try to preach. I don't want you to do anything. I want you to stay right here until you have received the promise." He told them they were going to receive something. But stay put until you have received the power. Stay put. See, the problem with the church is that we done took off. Oh, God, I got to. Lord have mercy. Give me a few more minutes. Give me a few more minutes. We done took off. But there is no tarrying or waiting for the promise. And see, you can't live the way God outlines you and I to live until there is some help. Oh, God. Jesus. Now, that's the problem. That's the problem. Reverend Bush, when you was talking so powerfully today, I was just thinking, Lord, have mercy. It's that there's something missing. And I don't care how many Bible studies you got. Doesn't matter how often you go to church. Doesn't matter how often you meet. There is an element that's missing within the church. I'm going to get to it. The reason why folk hating folk is because there's something missing. Now we can talk all day long about what it means to be a Christian. That's fine. Because if you notice Acts chapter 2, where I'm preaching from, these men had been in Bible study 3 whole years. They had been taught by the greatest teacher himself, Jesus the Christ. He had taught them for 3 years. They witnessed, they visualized the word, because he is the word. Not only did they visualize the word, they walked with the word. Not only did they walk with him, Pastor, but they was able to talk with the word. I don't know about you, but God wanna talk to us. We too busy. We got too much going on. We don't have time to listen to what God has to say. And so we make up these cliches and lies. Some of the Lord said we hadn't even sat still long enough to hear what thus said the Lord. I wish I had somebody over here to say amen. You see, we done brought too much of stuff in the body of Christ that's not from God. Because we talking about, I heard a voice from God. Baby, did you really hear? Because anything that causes you to contradict the word of God didn't come from God. Oh, God. Everything that sounds... Oh, Jesus, everything that sound good to you ain't good for you. Because a little bit of leaven will leaven the whole lump. All you got to do is just have a little bit of crazy doctrine and you'll tear up a church. Can I get a witness here? Notice in the text, and we out of here. Notice in the text in Acts chapter 2, the church is born. And it says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, that's how you know it was God. Suddenly. See, when God shows up, there is some stuff that happened that you can't explain. I want to drop this on your single folk. Just say suddenly. You ain't got to look for it. You're busy doing ministry, but suddenly, Lord, I praise you. You may have a little bit aching in the body, but you're praying and following God. And suddenly, somebody shout suddenly. That's how you know it's God, because God can suddenly fix it and put it in place. It doesn't take God all day. It doesn't take God all night. The Bible says, and suddenly, I need somebody to shout suddenly. Yeah, suddenly. They were all on one accord. In one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven. Watch this, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And the third verse says, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. See, it sat upon each of them. Each of them. They were all in one place. And it sat upon each of them. Because see, when you have the Holy Spirit within yourself, you're just a pilot light. Somebody gonna catch that by the time you get. See, when you got the Holy Spirit within self, you're just a pilot light. But when everybody is filled, you got a forest fire. Oh, Lord have mercy. I got to try to finish this. See, if you're just a pilot light, it doesn't take much for your light to go out. Because you just want, you just a pilot light. See, that's some of our problems. See, we put our own light out. And I don't know about you, but if you put one log in a fireplace, it don't heat up too good. It's gonna go out. But if you put log on top of log, on top of log, on top of log, you got some heat and it's hard to put it out. Why? Because you got all of those logs burning. God is saying here in the scripture that when the Spirit sat upon all of them, it was a burning church. And because it was a burning church, things began to happen that they couldn't even explain. That's when you know you've been filled. Because stuff began to happen. Notice the Bible says, it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. In other words, every nationality of folk was there, and they were able to hear each one of them in their own native language. Let me explain that for a moment, because sometimes I hope I don't want to mess with nobody. Can I just teach it? Because sometimes when you use this right here to talking about when the Spirit come upon you, you know, you're speaking tongues. If you read the text, the text that they spoke in other languages. Can I teach it? And then we're going to go to the house. See, other language, because see, you had all kind of people that was there. And these individuals able to speak in other language, get this, and they hadn't even gone to school for it. Whew. But when God shows up, the impossible. I wish I had somebody to know it tonight, that when God show up, the impossible becomes possible when he shows up. Well, in other words, what does all this mean, Pastor? What does this mean? What does it mean? What does it mean? What does it mean? See, how do you know when the church is full of the Holy Spirit? Because it lifts you from the earthly realm to the kingdom of God. See, what God wants us to do is not stay on earth. He wants us to be able to present kingdom principles, kingdom living to folk. In other words, if you put helium in a balloon, that balloon is not going to stay on the ground. You put helium in, it's going to rise to various levels. And when the Holy Spirit takes control of the church, it doesn't stay on earth. It rises to another level so that the folk of the world can say, what in the world is going on? No, notice the folk in the scripture. They start accusing them of being drunk with wine because they couldn't explain it. See, there are some things that God will do in your midst when the Holy Spirit is at work that folk with a natural mind just can't understand. You'll take a crack addict out of the house, out of the crack house, and make him a preacher. Can anybody do that but God? Can I get a witness here? He knows how to move, and he moves in a mighty way. Now, there was about 120 people that was gathered on that day. Can I tell you something? The problem, notice, the Bible says that it was a mighty rushing wind. Catch this now. See, when you mix wind with fire, you got a blaze. Now, I'm somebody going to catch that on the way. Lord, I wish I had time. As a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the house. See, that church on the day of Pentecost was a blazing church. The problem that we're having here today in our world is that we don't have folk that are filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Can I get a witness? How do you know when the church is filled and we go home with the Spirit? Because each individual collectively is doing things that are not natural. Can I get a witness? It's beyond their natural ability. In order for the church to be filled, the people got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, we ain't blaming it on COVID. I know that's what we talk about. Let me stay there for a moment. It ain't COVID. We use that as an excuse. The reason why attendance is down is because folk are not filled. There it is. Because when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, you won't make excuses. Can I get a witness up in here? Now, we got an opportunity. There's an opportunity to use COVID, but yet we go everywhere else. I wish I can preach it like I feel it. We go everywhere we want to go and have no problem doing it. But when it comes to the body of Christ, we got all kind of excuses for why we don't show up. I got this, I got that, I worked hard, I need some rest. But if you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, my God, Shirley Caesar says like a fire, that's shut up in your bone. You can't stay home when you have been filled with the Holy Spirit. Not only that, you can't stay home, but you can't treat folk bad when you've been filled. Let's go home. With the Holy Spirit. I'm going to holler at you two times and we out of here. Yeah, when you've been filled, when the church is filled with the Holy Spirit, souls will be saved. The Bible said Peter preached on the day of Pentecost. Lord, I wish I could have been there. He began to tell them about Jesus and all that Jesus had done. And the Bible says, under the unction of the Holy Spirit, 3,000 souls came to a saving grace in Jesus Christ. I know today we got to beg folk and have food programs and fix hot dogs and hamburgers and have all this kind of stuff. But if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, Lord, I praise you. You don't have to come up with those ways of trying to get folk to come to church or to be a part of the church. When the Holy Spirit falls on the church, Lord, not only will people be saved, but people will be delivered. Can I stay right there for a moment? No, we got to cut out this mess. Coming to church, being a part of the church, and still living in mess. Can I get a witness up in here? I know this is a little tight, but I got to preach it like God gave it to me. That while we're not perfect, but yet we ought to have some spirit in us. That when we do wrong, there's a Holy Spirit on the inside that convicts us of our wrong. Can I get a witness here? But if you can live in sin, I know it's not here at Hayden Baptist, but at your cousin's church, if you can live in sin, the Holy Spirit is not working with you. You're not filled with the Holy Spirit, because there ought to be something, the Holy Spirit of God, that tells you that God is not pleased with your actions. How can we say to God, I love you with all my heart, and we live in a life of sin? The Bible says, if you love me, then show me by keeping my commandments. Am I right about it? And that is the reason why we can't get folk to come to Jesus Christ, because the church is out of order. The church has lost her power. And when we get the power back by tarrying for the Spirit of God to fill each and every one of us, things will begin to happen. Lives will change. Folk will get delivers. Joy will come back. Peace will come back. Healing will take place when the Spirit is in the church. Folk that couldn't walk spiritually learn how to walk when they are part of a Spirit-filled church. And when the church is filled, you act unnatural. Things began to happen that you cannot explain. Folk on the outside will run to the church and say, I want to see what's going on at Mount Sinai Baptist, at Mount Zion, at Hayden Baptist. I want to see what's going on there, because there's some unnatural things that are happening. People are being helped. People are being delivered. People are being saved. Folk are falling out with their wicked ways. They are loving folk like they never loved folk before. They stop being judgmental, and they start being a loving group of people. I don't know about you, but I have to wake up every day and say, Lord, fill me, oh God, with your Spirit. Fill me. I don't know what I'm going to run into today, but fill me with your Spirit, so that when folk talk about me, I can still
bless them in spite of. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Is there anybody in the house tonight where you don't mind shouting, Lord, fill me? Look up toward heaven and say, fill me with your Holy Spirit. I'm so glad that Jesus died. I'm glad that he didn't stay dead, but early on the first day of week, he got up. Somebody say he got up. He got up with all powers in his hand. Power to make you walk right. Power to make you talk right. Power to make you live right. Power to make you preach right. Power to make you sing right. Power.
He's got all power. When the church experiences a revival, things change. The church don't remain the same. Now, the church don't remain the same. Bless you. The church don't remain the same when it has been filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, God wants us to be kingdom-minded people. He wants us to be kingdom citizens. In order for that, what God wants to do is take us to a whole nother realm, a whole nother dimension, so that we can understand the things of God while we're here on earth. There has to be a difference. We don't need to be around here competing with nobody. No, it's not even about a competition. And see, notice on the day of Pentecost, there was no competition. It was all on one accord in one place. I wish I had somebody right there to just agree with me. They were in one place. And the Bible says it filled the whole house where they were. The problem that we have in our churches is the direct result of the absence of the filling of the Holy Spirit. You got people in church that's trying to compete with other ministries. Folk that want stuff to go. I don't know, Pastor Bush, help me out if I'm wrong on this, but I don't know of anybody that owns the church other than Jesus Christ. Yeah, I quoted it. He said it in Matthew, upon this rock, ecclesia, I will build. I will build what? My church. And he said, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. It looks to me, if God is the architect of the church, then we ought to go to him and say, now, Lord, what do you want me to do? How do you want this reign? What are the kingdom principles? Because it's not mine. It belongs to you. Come on, somebody. And we got folk will leave the church, get full of hell because things don't go the way they want it to go. That's not being filled of the Holy Spirit. Things don't go. I must be honest. There are some things that I wish would go the way I want them to go. But God has to back me up and say, Carter, leave it to me because it belongs to me. You're stressing too much. You act, no. This is mine. I just told you the gates of hell should not prevail against it. Not only did I tell you that, but I said no weapon that's formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise against you, you shall condemn it. We run around here mad, like Reverend Moose said earlier, talking about one another. That's why we can't get folk to come to church, because we're not filled. Because when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, let me tell you something. Somebody come running somebody down to you, you shut it down. You shut that door. No. I'm not going to entertain that. I'm not going to entertain that. That's a problem. Come on, somebody. You can't win nobody to Christ. Let me tell you something. I'm gonna let you go. Because my church looking at me funny. They saying they're going to come back Sunday if I don't sit down. I'm going to be honest. I was talking to someone the other day at work. And they were talking about their family.
And they said, Pastor, they said, they don't like me because I tell the truth. And I said, then listen. Then when you speak to me, now I must be honest, from working with the individual for 30 years, I said to myself, and I ain't got nothing to do with you speaking the truth. It's about your character. They know you. See, sometimes, let me tell you something. The Bible says that the church ought to be salt and light. If folk don't want to hang around you, I'm going to say this and I'm going to sit down. You might need to check self out. Come on, somebody. Because Jesus had folk following him and he told them the truth. Now, yeah, there were times they left him and wouldn't walk with him, but he never come back. I'm scared of folk that talk about folk don't like me. I'm scared of that. Because if you treat everybody with dignity and respect and with love, I don't care what kind of truth you tell, they're going to respect you. If they don't want to have anything to do with you, look at your character. Because there are some folk, I'm going to sit down. There are some folk, Pastor Davis, that I don't care to be around. Can I be quite honest? I love them, but I can't be around them because they're from a total different dimension. And I ain't finna let them bring me down. I'm gonna love you at a distance. No. Because what I'm gonna do is be an example to you, but I'm not gonna allow you to be an example to me. I wish somebody would say something up in here. Some of us are just too mean, too evil, too much of a problem, and folk don't want to hang around. When you see a group of folk always hanging together, the same group, y'all preachers know it. You don't want to, y'all know it. Same folk, same circle. And Reverend Bush, when mess gets started, is coming from that circle. Watch out. When folk can only hang around a few people and not around the whole body, watch out. When you can only love and communicate with certain folk as a child of God and can't love and communicate with everybody, something is wrong. And when folk leave the ministry because of something you've done, You ought to fall on your face and repent and say, Lord, that person is not in ministry because of me. Something's wrong with that picture. We are responsible for bringing folk together. Reverend Bush said it a few minutes ago. The Bible said God has given us the ministry of reconciliation, not the ministry of division. Not the ministry of division, not the ministry of division, not the ministry of division, but the ministry of reconciliation. Bring people together. And not always running folk down because you don't like them. Can I get bold and say, who are you for somebody to like? Come on, somebody. When you experience a revival, you don't have that mess. When the Holy Spirit falls upon you, the Bible says you'll see it because the fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, joy. You can tell when folk are not filled. I know we say, oh, no, don't judge. Let me tell you something. The Bible said you'll know a tree by the fruit it bears. If you're bearing apples, I'm going to call you an apple tree. If you're bearing oranges, I'm going to call you an orange tree. Because that's the fruit that you're bearing. You have to call it like it is. Amen. Pastor Bush, Pastor Robinson, other pastors and preachers, Jesus was doing ministry and he had been preaching and teaching and he fed the people and the people began to follow him. And Jesus turns around and he says, you're not following me because of me. You're following me because you did eat of the loaves. And he's the first pastor that I've ever known that lost the entire congregation except for 12 men in one day. So brothers, don't get upset when folk tip out. Because when they tip out, tip more will come back in. Especially when you are teaching and preaching the truth. The Bible said, let the wheat and the tares grow together. Let them grow together. And I'll do the separating. Folk that are demonized ain't gonna sit under the word. They're gonna get mad and walk out and try to scandalize your name. But Jesus will fight your battles for you. Every step of the way, he'll fight your battles because you got to have the energy to preach and teach, and you can't be weighted down with dead weight. Give it to the Lord and keep preaching. I don't care if but four show up. Preach to them four like you're preaching to 4,000 and watch God bring the increase. The experiencing of the Holy Spirit of God. God bless you and may heaven smile upon you tonight. Amen.
Red Hot Revival. Amen. We're going to ask the musicians to give us something. We don't want to just take for granted that everybody in the house is saved. Amen. We know every Sunday folk come to church, but everybody ain't saved. So we're going to open the doors of the church and present opportunity that if there's anybody who wants to accept Christ as their Savior on tonight, we give you that opportunity to come. You might want to become a candidate for water baptism. Through Christian experience or by letter.
Jesus.
Or maybe you just know that your relationship is not right. But however the Spirit of God leads you to come, we give you that opportunity.
Be pray. Oh, pray.
Will there be one tonight?
Praise him. Praise him, oh Lord, praise him, Jesus, bless his name, yeah, he was there to, yeah, be praised, say it again, praise him.
May be seated if you can.
Praise him, oh Lord.
You and God got going.
Praise him.
You and God got going.
Praise him. Jesus. Bless his Savior. He was there to be.
We thank God for the message. We thank God for the message. We pray that God would keep him with good health and strength, that he might be able to preach such gospel for years to come. Concerning Ministers Fellowship, I want to say thank you. God has done just what we asked him to do, and that is to send us a revival.
Yes, sir.
And let it begin with me. Again, we want to say thank you to Dr. Robinson and the Hayden Missionary Baptist Church family for hosting us once again, for all of his many talents. And we call him the maestro of media. Amen. Because he can make stuff do stuff. Amen. Amen. Is the house open tonight? Amen. For everyone. So immediately after we dismiss, please feel free to go into the fellowship hall and get you some refreshments on your way home. We're not going to keep you long. Reverend Glover, thank you for pressing your way and coming back with us all the way from Martinez on tonight. We thank you. All of those who came throughout this week, amen. And it is our prayer as I get ready to turn it back to Reverend Carter that he might be able to close us in his own way, that every foot that trod upon these grounds on this week, that their lives will never be the same simply because they passed by this way on this week. And to God be the glory for all that he has done. Amen.
Again, I just want to say I bless the Lord for each of you. Thank you so very much. It's been quite an experience. You keep doing what you're doing. And we bless the Lord. Whatever we can do, however we can help, whatever we can do to assist, we don't mind. Just call on us. And if our schedule allows it, we certainly will. Amen. Because we got to get it back. We got to get the church back to where God died for her to be. Amen. There's too much mess going on. God bless you. Love each and every one of you. Thanks so very much. Let us stand now.
Stay connected this winter with this unbeatable deal.
Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we come right now to say thank you. Thank you, Father, for the revival all week long. And I pray, Father God, like you did on the day of Pentecost, move by your spirit within our hearts. That folk that see us will want a part of what we're doing for you, oh God. And Lord, if whatever areas we have fallen short, we confess it as a sin before you, Lord, and we ask you for your forgiveness. We repent of it right now. God, fill us. Fill us individually as well as collectively with your spirit, sir. Do it only for the asking. And then, Father God, as we bless everybody that is here under the sound of your word, keep your arms of protection around all. Lord, help the ministry to continue to grow, to be all that you would have it to be. We'd be so honored to give your name the glory. Now, Father, as we go to our various places and destinations, please give us safe traveling grace. And Lord, until we meet again, may the love of God, the peace of God rest, rule henceforth and forevermore is our prayer. And let us all say amen.
Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen.
So here's my worship.
Please make your way to the fellowship hall. We're going to ask that all ministers, if you would, please come up front quickly. Let us get our group picture before we go to the fellowship hall.
Here's my worship smile. Here's my life, Lord.
You got to raise it a little louder and I'll say, here's my worship.
Here's my worship smile.
Come on, raise it before I'm saying,
here's my life, Lord, smile.
Oh, here's my
worship smile.
Give it all over to you, Lord.
Here's my life, Lord, smile.
Come on, shout that out one more time. Here's my worship.
Here's my worship smile.
Come on, raise it before I'm saying, here's my life, Lord.
Here's my life, Lord.
This time we're going to shout it out. Say, here's my worship.
Here's my worship smile.
Dwell here. You live here. Here's my life.
Reverend Marcellus, Robert, can we please get you up front? Reverend Michelle Bush, can we please get you up front?
Again,
Give it to you. You won't let me down. You won't break my heart. You won't let me fall. So I give it to you. So you won't let me down.
You won't let me down.
You won't break my heart.
You won't break my heart.
You won't let me fall.
You won't let me
so
fall.
I give it to you.
So I give it to you.
You won't let me down.
Yeah. Planet Fitness Black Card is packed with perks, not like other gyms.
Hi, can I bring a friend to work out? Okay. Is my membership good at other locations? Okay. Do you have any other amenities?
But at Planet Fitness, the PF Black Card gets you tons of perks. Bring a friend for free anytime. Access to any of our 2,500 plus locations. Relax in the hydro massage and so much more. Join for just $1 down, $24.99 a month. Cancel anytime. Deal ends March 15th. See Home Club for details.
Verbo Vacation Homes come with 24/7 live support. So if you ever need anything, you can reach a real person in about a minute. Because if it's 4 a.m. and you need assistance, the last thing you want to do is wait to talk to a robot.
Hey, how can I help?
After all, live support is an amenity every vacation home should have. Verbo, private vacation rentals for you and your people.
thank you for it all. The good, bad, the ugly, great and small. The times of victory and when I fall. I'm so grateful that I'm still standing tall. I thank you for my tears. The pain helped me overcome my fears. You've been good to me down throughout the years. It's a miracle that I'm still